welcome to Northland. It's so great to see all you guys. Would you please stand up and sing with us as we worship our God? Just one word, you calm the storm that surrounds me. Just one word, the darkness has to retreat. Oh, just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes are open to see. I can't help but believe there's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that he can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Just one word, you heal what's broken inside. Just one word, and you revive every dream. Just one touch, my eyes are open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that he can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Oh, there's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a prison wall he can't break through. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. Oh.
Let's sing this out together.
I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. So let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus.
Sing it.
I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power.
I give you glory for all you've brought me through. And now I'm ready for whatever you want to do. I'm moving forward to follow after you. And now I'm ready for whatever you want to do. Oh, We want his presence like never before. Like never before. You may be seated, Northland. Thank you so much for joining us this morning. We're so glad to be in the house of worship. It's wonderful to be able to worship like this, don't you think? It's wonderful. For all of you online, we love having you with us as well. We're so glad that everyone's here to take in Pastor Rob's teaching today. He'll be teaching on the second part of the Noah story. You want me to build a what? Along the way, right? You're welcome. But all of that shows God's amazing faithfulness to his people. And we're going to hear a lot about that today. Wow. 2021 is here, and we're still here. We're still moving forward amidst a time like we've never seen before, right? That word, I don't like to say it very often, pandemic. You know, we've been in it now quite a while. For those of you who don't know, my name's Tony, and I've been very, very lucky to be a part of the Northland Worship Team on and off for what seems like a long time and a long, wonderful time. But when I haven't been able to be here and sing and have a great time worshiping with other believers, I've been working my entire life in the music industry, what used to be the music industry and entertainment industry. Live performances with a couple different groups that I've performed with for a long, long time. I've served as a music director for groups and a clinician for groups all around the country and the world. My life for more than 25 years has been at home, and obviously, like I said, being able to worship here and be here and have a family along the way. But so much of my life has been outside of the Orlando area, actually spending a lot of time on planes and traveling and being able to share music and teach along the way. A Delta frequent flyer through the years. A 2 million miler even along the way, because I was flying so much through the years. And I'm here to tell you that God is faithful. My last time on a plane was March 12th of last year. After being on a plane sometimes two and three times a week for 20 plus years, and connecting with people through singing and through teaching, the last rehearsal I did like that was on March 15th of 2020. And on March 16th, we went into this lockdown. And in a lot of ways, in my industry anyway, we're still there. But God is faithful. And I am so thankful for the amazing people here, associations that I have with amazing people on the stage right now that I've known for a long time, who are also faithful followers of our Lord, who've given me the opportunity to continue to make music. And I'm speaking this morning simply from a place of thankfulness, and thankful for a father who hasn't left me in the last 10 months, because without my faithful father, I think days and weeks and months would have been pretty gray. Now, I'll be really honest, there have definitely been a lot of gray days over the last 10 months, because as a father, as a husband, as someone who is very conscientious about working and doing what I need to do to support my family, the flesh just wins. I got to take care of us. I got to take care of me and those around me. And that was extremely important to me. So there are a lot of gray days. But even just in kind of thinking about things that I was going to share this morning, what I realized was that those gray days were not days that I was focusing where I should be focused, where I was trying to keep my hands on the wheel of my life to steer it instead of being able to go, Lord, this is really for you, because you
are my faithful Father, and you will take care of this. And he has. And he's taking care of each one of us every step of the way. My perspective is so narrow. I think a lot of our, I don't mean it disrespectfully, I think a lot of our perspectives can be pretty narrow. But his story has been going on long before I got here. And thank God his story is going to be going on way after I leave this place. And for that, I am so thankful. I'm thankful for a faithful Father who in every step of my life, every step of your life, cares for his people, will take care of us, and he will not stop working for us.
just rest in God's faithfulness these few moments right here? For He alone is trustworthy. When we're tired, when we have failed, He is faithful. So thankful for only His testimony of God's faithfulness this morning. So thankful that in times when I'm going through the storm, God is faithful. Amen. Let's pray. God, in this moment, we just rest in that You are faithful. God, as we have just sung, when we don't see every part, we know that we can trust You. God, even in this moment and in this season when our search team is interviewing and calling and talking to prospects about coming and leading this congregation, Father, I'll lift them up before You this morning and pray for endurance. Lord, when they can't see the end, God, give them strength to carry on. Father, we are thankful that You are not finished yet with us as Your children, with us as a church. You are not finished yet. And God, as Your people, we want to continue to worship You, to praise You, till the dry bones wake, the mountains shake, and the darkness breaks. We want to be a people sing praises to You, O God. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, good morning. Glad you guys are here. If you are joining us online this morning, so glad that you are with us. If you're here in the room, so glad that you're with us and excited to see what God is going to do in these next few moments. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn to Hebrews chapter 11. You know, last week, we continued our overarching series, which is Against All Odds. And I continued as what we're going to do is we're going to introduce you and walk through with some of these Old Testament incredible men and women of God in the Old Testament, testimonies of faith. And through that, watch the theme kind of interweave of one scripture, one story, one Savior, as it's interwoven through the Old Testament into the New Covenant and through the New Testament. And we're going to take this from here all the way to Easter, through Lent, all the way to Easter Sunday, or as I call Super Sunday. Now, when they said, hey, when we're talking about, hey, the title of the series is going to be Against All Odds, I said, hey, the second week that I'm preaching, I need Phil Collins here to sing the song Against All Odds, okay? Like, that's just, can we work on that? So I'm still waiting. I'm hoping they'll come out before we're done today, but so far, nothing. But I was excited because I got to do a fun story. Now, this is the story of Noah that we started last week. And remember last week I said, you know, I brought my Noah playset back out. And after today, you're welcome to take it home, play with it for a few weeks. You guys can trade it out, whatever you want to do. But remember what we said last week is when we think about this, this is kind of the image that comes to mind, right? Like it's this, it's the playset, it's the coloring book pages. Remember what also we said is that if we only talk about what happens above the waterline, that we diminish God's justice. And if we only talk about what happens below the waterline, we diminish God's mercy, God's grace. And I know last week was heavy. We talked a lot about what happened below the waterline. And this week I want to take us above the waterline and find out what happens, how the story of Noah continues. So, when we left last week, they were still on the boat. So are you guys ready? We got to get Noah and his family off the boat this morning. You ready? Let's go. So we pick up the word of God in Hebrews, and we start there. And Noah was, as we learned last week, Noah was a pretty faithful guy. I mean, God did ask him to do some things, and he was faithful. He was found blameless in the eyes of the Lord. It says that he was greatly faithful. It says he looked very different in comparison to the rest of his generation. Hebrews 11:7 says this, says, by faith, Noah, being warned by God concerning the events as yet unseen, in reverent fear constructed an ark for the saving of his household. By this, he condemned the world and became an heir of righteousness that comes by faith. Now, Noah does what God asked him to do out of reverent fear. Plus, it sounded way better than drowning at that moment, right? And so he does this. He does what God asked him to do. And it says here that he was granted faith. He was granted righteousness. Now, Hebrews chapter 11, we call that the Hall of Faith. And there's some heavy hitters that are in the Hall of Faith, right? There's some names. You look at the names that are in the Hall of Faith in Hebrews chapter 11, and you're like, yeah, that makes sense. I mean, and then there's some you're kind of going, huh. But Noah, he's in there, and he says that he was granted righteousness. Not everybody has that asterisk next to their name. Noah, great man of faith. It's interesting that throughout this story, the story of the flood, the story of Noah's ark, whatever you want to call it, that throughout this story, once the door is closed and the ark begins to take flow, we don't hear a lot about the words of Noah. In fact, very little is recorded. We got to believe that there's a lot of conversation going on between those 8 adults and all those animals, right? But nothing is recorded in Genesis about what Noah actually says. Here's why. Because the actual main character of this story is not Noah. The actual main character of this story is God. And in this picture, we see God's faithfulness. We see God's mercy. God's continually above the waterline, below the waterline, even keel. This is just another side of who God is. And from this story, I want us to pull out 3 aspects this morning about Noah's run through faith. And this is the faith is a pleasing aroma. Faith is a pleasing aroma. Ephesians 5:2 says, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. We'll come back to that verse in just a second. So the reality of this voyage, right? The reality of this voyage is that we see the Bible says there's 40 days and 40 nights of rain. Yes, that is true. It also says that the ark was afloat for 150 days. Yes, that is true. But if you read the whole story and you do the math, they were on that ark for 370 days. That's right. A 370-day cruise to the mountains of Ararat, full of animals and lots of family drama, leaving tonight at 7, who's getting on board? Right? That just does not seem like it's going to be the scene where we're going to find the aroma of faithfulness. Maybe some other aromas, but not faithfulness. But Noah, they get to what they think is to dry land. He tests that. He tests the status of the dry land. He sends the birds out. If you haven't read the story in a while, you need to go back and read it. But he sends the birds out. He comes back and he gets confirmation that they're on dry land. But he waits 2 more months before they get off the boat. 2 more months. They're at dry land. They can see it. They're there. But he waits 2 more months. Why? Because God had not told them to get off of the boat yet. I mean, you got to think that, like, he's getting questions like, are we there yet? Hey, Dad, are we there yet? Have we made it yet? How do we know that we're there yet? We don't even know where we're going, Dad. Noah's like, my people. Come on. I mean, to me, that's kind of like, you know, remember that first time that you loaded up all your kids in the back seat, your first trip to Disney World? And, you know, just like the commercial, you picture this, right? Your kids picture it, right? The door's going to fly open and everybody's going to jump out and they're going to be running in slow motion, see who can get to the front gate fast. Minnie and Mickey are there waiting with open arms and a free balloon. Yeah, it didn't happen for us like that either, but... But this, it's like this. It's like pulling in the parking lot at Disney. Dad, I see it. Let's go. Actually, kids, stay seated. I'm going to take the next 20 minutes, and I'm going to go over the rules and regulations of the park. And then I'm going to turn it over to Mom, and for the next half hour, she's going to go over our daily schedule today. But Dad, it's right there. I can see it. Frontierland, Galaxy's Edge, those cool Mickey Mouse ear ice cream bar things. It's right there. Ready to get off the boat, but Noah doesn't. He stays put. Verse 14 says, in the second month, on the 27th day of the month, the earth had dried out. Then God said to Noah, go out from the ark, you and your wife and your sons and your sons' wives with you. Down to verse 18, they went out. It was time. Get off. Time to disembark the ark. Let's go. And so they do it. God told Noah to go and do something, and then he does it. And then God's voice goes silent for 10 months. 10 months. Though Noah arrived at what he thought was the culmination of the end of his assignment, the end of his job, he has to continue being faithful, heading in that same direction, waiting on the voice of the Lord before he goes on. You know, I don't know what you're dealing with this morning or what you're facing right now, but you know that God has called you to something. In fact, you dropped everything that you were doing because God was calling you into something. And then when you got through there, just like in the story, God's voice may have gone silent. I mean, it was super clear. He created the doorway, you walked through it, he called you in, and then his voice goes silent. I think sometimes we get too impatient and we lose sight of where we're headed. And we should follow Noah's example here, because what he does, Scripture says, he continues walking in the same direction until he hears God's voice again. He continues waiting on the Lord. So maybe we should take heed of that example. I know I get impatient sometimes. Isaiah says in 40:31 says, "But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint." Here's what's going to happen. Eventually, God's voice, just like in the story, is going to show up in your life again. And God's going to direct you and he's going to guide you and tell you exactly what he wants you to do. You just stay the course. Easier said than done. Proverbs 3:5-8 says, "Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding." I don't know about you, but I love altering that my understanding. Don't you? Like, we love altering our understanding. Lean not on your own understanding. Oh, I got this. I'm walking in something and suddenly I feel like I'm not hearing God. I'm like, oh, well, maybe he meant this. So I'll go over here. Oh, maybe he meant this. And the next thing you know, like I said last week, Rob starts following the desires of Rob's heart and puts it in the ditch. Right, we have to stay the course. Trust the process. You've heard that phrase. I coach basketball, my son's team, his school team, and my good friend Matt Hand is here today, the fellow coach, and his family. And so we're coaching these guys. We've been coaching them for the same group for a few years now. And so this last year, we kind of went up to the next level. And so we're teaching these plays and these concepts before the season starts. And the first couple games start to happen. And they're out there. We're calling these plays. Matt's calling these plays. Like, we're running this. They're like, okay. And they go out. And we're like, we've taught them, like, you have to trust the process. You have to go. All five people on the court have to go to where they need to go. We'll create a path to get the ball down low, and we score. Pretty simple, right? Except for 11-year-olds. Because everybody wants to go. Everybody gets impatient and wants to go where the action is, where the ball is, right? And we have to stay the course. We have to trust the process. And so game one happens. We go back to practice. Guys, come on. Game two happens. Call the play. Same thing. Guys, come on. Back to game three. Call the play. It happens. We score. These guys go running back down the court like they just won the NBA championship. I mean, they're like, yeah. And they're looking at Coach Matt and I like, it worked, yeah. And we're like, yeah. It did work. And I wonder if sometimes if that's how God sees me. Rob, I drew the play. I don't know what you didn't understand about it. This is what I called you to. Stay the course. Trust the process. I will be faithful. Proverbs goes on to say, he says, verse 6, "In all your ways acknowledge him, and he will make straight your paths. Be not wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and turn away from evil. It will be healing to your flesh and refreshment to your bones." Psalm 27:14, "Wait for the Lord, be strong and let your heart take courage." Wait for the Lord. You see, the journey of faithfulness is a pleasing aroma to the nostrils of God. You look what Noah does next as we follow the storyline in Genesis 8:20. It says, "Then Noah built an altar to the Lord and took some of every clean animal and some of every clean bird and offered burnt offerings on the altar. And when the Lord smelled the pleasing aroma, the Lord said in his heart, I will never again curse the ground because of man, for the intention of man's heart is evil from his youth. Noah has just spent the last year of his life trying to keep all these smelly things alive, right? Making sure they're cared for, they're fed, and rationing out the food for, oh, I don't know, how long are we going to be on this ark? You just don't know. And so he does a great job. It's a job. This wasn't like a pleasure cruise at all. And he does a great job getting all the animals and his family there safely. They get off the boat, and the first thing Noah does is they have a worship service. He builds an altar, and he takes these animals that they've been saving, and he sacrifices them unto the Lord. And God was pleased with the aroma of Noah's faithfulness. That's what he's desiring for us. Never underestimate how much it pleases God when we are faithful. Never underestimate that. I'm talking about like the day-to-day faithfulness stuff. You say, Rob, my life is just not that exciting. I wake up, I pray, I read a word, and then I go to work, and I serve my boss, I serve my coworkers. I come home, I serve my family. Night I go, I may go to a Bible study. I call and check on my friends. I do life with them, that kind of thing. Yes. That's the faithfulness. That's the everyday life type of faithfulness. That is pleasing in the eyes of God. That is a pleasing aroma to God. Let that never get old. Let that never get old. 2 Chronicles 69 says, or Psalm 146 says, but the Lord takes pleasure for those who fear him and those who hope in his steadfast love. 2 Chronicles, for the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to give strong support to those whose heart is blameless towards him. And I love Psalm 37:3 says, trust in the Lord and do good, dwell in the land and befriend faithfulness. My favorite version, NASB, says, and cultivate faithfulness. Maybe your version says, and feed on faithfulness. It's the everyday stuff. When we are faithful, God is pleased. Next thing faith calls us to is to bend and not break. So it would be great if the story of Noah ended right there. Like after they have this great worship service, God is pleased. Noah just goes on. It says Noah goes on to be a faithful man for the rest of his life, never fails. His kids and his grandkids go on to be men and women of great faith in the eyes of God, and Noah just rides off into the sunset, right? But if you've read ahead, you know that that's not what happens. In fact, when we were talking with Pastor Gus and deciding who was going to do which character, he says, you're going to do Noah. And I was like, okay, cool. And I started reading, I was like, hold on a second, Pastor Gus. I get the verse that deals with Noah in the tent, that whole thing. Yeah, brother, that one's yours. We got to deal with this. We can't skip it. And there's some application here. Look what it says. It says, chapter 9, verse 20, says that Noah began to be a man of the soil, and he planted a vineyard, meaning he's working in agriculture, right? And he's learning his way around the vineyard and reaping the harvest, maybe a little too much. I don't know what happened. Noah just loses his mind here. Takes his eyes off God for a second. And I mean, the first picture we have of Noah is this faithful guy, builds an ark, does this great thing for God. And then the next, we get this, like, what, flashback to his college days? I don't know what this is. This is like drunk, naked camping. If that were a reality show, this would be it, right? I mean, that's not your typical night at Fort Wilderness. Not for me, anyway. I don't know. So Noah is in this tent. He's in a drunken stupor. He's naked. And to make things worse, his son Ham walks in on him and makes matters worse because he doesn't show great respect to his father. In fact, he's like going, whoa, what's going on here? And he goes out the front of the tent and he gets his brothers. He's like, guys, check this out. He's like, hey, guys, come over here. Let's take a selfie. Hashtag don't tell mom. Like, this is crazy stuff. And so thankfully, his brothers are more mature. They're wiser. And so they say, bro, you need to chill. And to show great respect for their father, they put a canvas across the backs of their shoulders and they back in to the tent and they cover their father. And they walk out having never seen him in that way. And Noah wakes up from whatever this was. His first words are, "Cursed be Canaan," which was Ham's son. Cursed be Canaan. Because here's the thing, Noah has learned a hard lesson about how serious God is with our sin. We talked about that last week. And is deciding in this moment that he, as a dad, is going to be serious about sin. And he says, "Cursed is Canaan." But why? He says, "Because what you did was foolish. What you've done is sinful." So he deals with the sin, and then the very next sentence he says, "But blessed be the Lord, the God of Shem." Kind of in the same way that he responded when God reached down and saved and rescued his family, and then he got off the boat and he worshiped and blessed the name of the Lord. Here too, he realizes that sin is sin, that it needs to be dealt with. But in the next sentence, he says, "The blessed is the name of the Lord," and worships him. You see, this is the part of the story, at least for me, where I start to realize that in the midst of our faithfulness, that I still have the capability of making very poor choices. That this is where, as followers of Christ, that even with great faith, we still have the tendency to act like a fool. The Apostle Paul was dealing with this in Romans chapter 7. He was wrestling with this. In fact, this is what he says. He says, "So I find it to be a law that when I want to do right, evil lies close at hand. For I delight in the law of God in my inner being." What he's saying is, because I want to do the right thing, my desire is to delight in the law of the Lord. Verse 22, "But I see in my members another law waging war against the law of my mind and making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members." In other words, I want to do the right thing, but I've still got this thing. I want to delight in the law of the Lord, but there's this thing inside me that wants to delight in the law of sin. It's what we wrestle with. You see, this is the fight, the battle you and I, we face every single day, right? I mean, there's going to come a day when you and I will be perfected, and when all we're going to want to do is worship the Lord and delight in the law of the Lord. God, may that day come soon, right? But right now we're in this place where we want to delight in the law of the Lord, but there's still this thing that from outside influences and what's inside is that we have this thing where we wrestle, delighting in the law of sin. And Paul finds himself in this situation. And then in verse 24, he poses this question. He said, "Wretched man that I am, who will deliver me from this body of death?" And I think Paul's response to the question there is what yours and my response should be today. He says, "Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord." Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Thanks be to God that through Jesus I have forgiveness. Thanks be to God that through Jesus I have mercy. That even in my best attempts to live a faithful life, I'm still going to fail. And even so, he still offers me forgiveness, grace, and mercy, and still invites me to the table. Invites me to be a part of his family. That's who our God is. Third thing that the faith calls us to is to build and to board. Faith calls us to build and to board. What I mean by that is this. Last week I said, come back this week, and we would answer the question, where do you park an ark? Someone actually like called in, got message to it this week that like, "Hey, I got a place over by the Intercoastal. Does that work?" I'm excited. So when we get it, we'll see when we find it. But here's the thing. There are currently two active searches going on right now in the world for the remnants of Noah's Ark. One is being led by the gentleman who found the Titanic. Can you imagine raising those two boats up at the same time and tell the contrasting stories of what happened there? Crazy. So he thinks it's out there somewhere near around the Baltic Sea. The other gentleman was, I think, the eighth astronaut that walked on the moon. He came back and took over a search in Turkey. And this is where, near the mountains of Ararat, where he thinks this is. And he's having to deal with some government issues with Turkey and trying to get this search put back on. And so anyway, here's the thing. Whatever either of these discoveries lead to, it's still not going to answer the question. And here's why. Because sometimes God asks us to build the ark, to board the ark, and trust him with where it's going. You see, when we're serving, when we're being faithful to a holy God, an almighty God, you see, a lot of times it's more about the journey than it is the landing. Friend, I don't know what God is calling you to today. Maybe in 2021, God's been stirring your heart like, this is what you're going to do. And you're like, what? Maybe God's calling you to build an ark, and you're like, Rob, I don't even know if I have the right tools and materials to do this. I don't know if I'm the right person. God's been stirring in your heart. You're the right person for the job. And whatever it is that God is calling you into, I know there's fear and trepidation. I know there's anxiety about that. Listen, God is calling me into some things to do this year. God's calling me into some things that I've got to step into. I have to start picking up my hammer and nails and start building my own ark. And for you, that may be something big. It may be something that just, maybe something small. Maybe it's something that serves your entire family. Maybe it's something that serves your entire community. Maybe God's calling you to a ministry that has not even begun yet. And whatever that looks like in your life this morning, I want to pray for you. I want to be faithful to pray for you as you start that building process. Listen, there is no building permit that will pass City Hall when you can't show them what the end result's going to look like, right? But our God doesn't work that way. Because our God says, step into it, start picking your hammer up, pick your nails up, pick your materials up, start building the ark that I have called you to build. For Noah, his culture looked completely different, didn't understand a thing that he was doing until it started raining. And if you and I are living a faithful life, and we're preaching that there's a rainy day coming, we better be building an ark in our backyard. Our lives need to show it. So this morning, I want to pray for you. No pressure at all, but I know this. I love those moments when I'm forced to step into those. God's saying, Rob, step. Here's what I'm calling you to. And I'm like going, this guy? But I love those moments, but here's the thing. I'm a lot better in those moments when I know that God's people, when the body of Christ is praying for me, and that they're with me on this. And so I want to just say, like, I want to pray for you this morning. So in these moments, the band is going to come in a few minutes, and we're going to celebrate God's faithfulness with communion this morning. Amen. And we're going to do that in just a minute. But before we do that, I don't want you to leave here thinking you're going out on this alone. We're all praying for each other. We're all praying for you. And I trust that you'll pray for me as I step into what I'm doing this year. 2021 is going to look different. Thank God. God's getting ready to do something here at Northland. Thank God. God is stirring the heart of a man and his family right now. They're going to come and they're going to lead this congregation. Praise God. As we step into that, whatever God is calling us to, whatever he's calling us to build, I'm going to give you an opportunity now. If you want to stand and be prayed for, whatever, and maybe this is about to be an announcement to your family. I don't know. Or if you just want to sit, this is just a moment between you and God. That's great. Let's pray. Let's pray for each other. You can stand or you can sit, whatever you want to do. God, I pray for what you have called us into this year. God, it may be big, it may be small. I pray that whatever that it is, God, you would number our steps, that you would pave the way. God, that you would make it crystal clear that what we're about to step into has been called by your voice. God, whatever we're stepping into, may it look radically different from the culture that is around us. Father, would you embolden us? Would you give us courage today to begin to pick up these materials, to begin to pick up these tools and building the ark that you've called us to build? God, it's going to be hard in some moments. The aroma is not going to be great in some moments. But God, you will be pleased with our faithfulness. And may we be found faithful as a people as we step into whatever this is. Father, you are mighty. And I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And all God's people said. Hey, I want to invite you into this next moment. If you're here this morning with us in person, or if you're online, grab whatever you can. As you came in, you received one of these. We are not trying to cheapen this moment of the service at all. This is just for safety precautions. Just a logistical thing. The top layer will give you access to the wafer. The second layer will give you access to the juice. If you'll just hold on, I want us to spend some time in just reflecting on what this means and where we are before a holy God this week. So the band's going to start playing in a minute. At that moment, I want you just to spend some time just reflecting. And then when you're ready, when you're prompted, you can partake. You know, the Bible tells us that final supper with Jesus and his disciples, it was simple. It was bread and wine, and it could have been anything, but he kept it simple. There was so much going on in that room that night, much of which the disciples didn't even know was happening. I mean, in that room, Jesus has called out two that will betray him. In that room, Jesus spoke words that they just could not understand and conceive what was about to happen. As he says, this is where I'm about to go and what's about to take place. And as we reflect upon that, we reflect about his words, and afterwards he went to pray. But right there in those moments, he just broke it down and made it simple. He took the bread, he broke it open. He says, this represents my body, broken for you. The bread, and then he took the wine. He says, this is the blood of the new covenant. It has been shed for many. And he's saying this as he's looking them in the eyes. And I can't imagine how heavy those statements were for the guys in that room. But what he meant was that his blood was shed, that he went to the cross to pay for the iniquities of us all, the sin of all of us. And if you're here today, man, I hope that you're reflecting, that you're taking part in this as a commemoration and a proclamation of what Jesus has done for you. If you're here today and you've never taken communion, never been a part of the Lord's Supper, I want to take this moment and just say, I want to invite you into this relationship with Jesus, that you might trust him alone for your salvation and what he did on the cross, that you would believe that he rose from the dead and sits at the right hand of the Father. The Bible says we all, like sheep, have gone astray. We all have sinned and fallen short of God's glory. But praise God, he sent a rescue boat for us, right? And his name was Jesus. Jesus went to the cross that you and I may have life and have life eternally. So let's reflect in these next few moments. As he told them to drink, and every time they eat the bread, every time they drink the wine, they do this in remembrance of who he was to them and what he did on the cross. So let's take these next few minutes. Make sure that we are in good standing with the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And then when you feel prompted, you can take your elements as the band leads us. Church is the beginning of a new day. Tomorrow when we go out and we start building, it's not going to look normal according to the world, right? but we're going for it. Whatever God is calling us to, we're going for it. And when the darkness tries to hide, look, we're going to say the name of Jesus. Say it with me on three. One, two, knee. One, two, three. Jesus. Amen. Because that name chases away the darkness, right? Chases away the darkness. So whatever you're walking into in these next few days, let's go. Chase away the darkness with the power of the name of Jesus. What is your next steps? Hopefully, you know, we love doing life together. Life together is just better, right? We can run the race together. And so we've got some practical ways. If you want to get the digging deeper guide, this will just kind of go into more details of what we've been talking about, what we're going to be talking about here from the stage over the next several weekends. Go online at northlandchurch.net/worship guide. There's ways that you can get connected there. We got new groups starting up, small groups, longer grow, all these different things, ways for you to get connected with the body. We want to see you do that. Here's a tradition that we do at Northland. I've grown to love this. If you would just extend the palms of your hands out as we leave this place. Just a blessing as we go where we're going. God knows where you're going. And may you be blessed as you leave this place today. May you take with you the name of Jesus everywhere that you go. May your life look different as Noah's life looked different. May your faithfulness this week and beyond bring a pleasing aroma to the Lord God Most High. And all God's people said, amen. Go, be blessed, be faithful.